Following the adoption of the Declaration of Independence, the Second Continental Congress had to adhere to the task of forming a new government for these nation states that the colonies had become. The colonies began to declare their independence. In fact, Virginia declares its independence from Great Britain on July 2nd, 1776. But they begin to declare themselves independent nation states, much like what we see in Europe. And what they end up doing, as you know, as we talked about, is forming a confederacy. Now, these states that originally had some very similar state constitutions, at least in some ways. First of all, each of these colonies adopted a permanent government, and they were sovereign. In other words, they had complete control over their foreign policy, complete control over who was their friend, who was their enemy. They were completely independent nations. Secondly, eight of them had a Bill of Rights, including Virginia, incorporated into their state constitution. They had a representative government, a Republican government of elected representatives, and the government was limited. It had certain powers. And most of them were at least loosely based on the charters that they had acquired from the King of England. And so they came up with the Articles of Confederation, which was the first national constitution. And the government under the Articles essentially created a legal friendship. There was no strong central government. It was an organization that the state could leave at will. And they realized that. They had a unicameral legislature that governed this loose confederation. And in that unicameral or single body legislature, they had one vote per state, no matter what size the state was. And each state could bring 2 to 7 delegates, but when it came time to cast the vote, they could only cast one. And while they had the unicameral legislature, they did not have an executive or a judicial branch. They did have an executive committee that had very little power. I mean, this is how afraid they were of having a king or someone that might have the power of the king, and they had no judicial branch to adjudicate any kind of dispute over national law. So the powers that were given under the Articles of Confederation essentially were these. These are the powers that they had in writing, at least. The power to make war and peace on behalf of the 13 nations. The power to send ambassadors on behalf of these 13 nations as a representative of the United States of America. The ability to sign treaties. The right and supposedly the ability to raise an army and a navy. The right to set a standard measure for weights and other types of measures that would be used in trading between the various states. They had the ability to handle Indian affairs and to settle disputes between the states. Now, these are the powers that they had in writing. In actuality, many of these powers were bogus at best. For example, there were a number of weaknesses under the Articles. For one, they had no power to tax. They could only ask states for money. I could come and ask you to help supplement my teaching pay. I could come and ask everyone in my class to do so. There's no incentive to do that. And the same is without the power to tax, all the national government could do would be to ask for donations from the states. And there was no real incentive for that to occur. So they had no money, or very little money. They could not regulate trade, either between the states or foreign trade. And this became a major stumbling block, particularly as the larger states with the stronger economies kind of lorded that over the states with weaker economies. They couldn't enforce their laws. The national government could pass a law, But if the state of Virginia didn't want to abide by it, or the state of North Carolina didn't want to abide by it, there was no way to force them to abide by the national law. So while they had trouble, and we'll see why in a moment, while they had trouble passing laws, the laws that they did pass were impotent. They had no real force behind them. They needed 9 states to enact new laws, so you needed 9 out of 13 states to vote in favor of a measure. That's a super majority. You know, Congress right now is has a very low public approval rating, under 10%. And it's largely because they're having such difficulty passing legislation, getting anything done. They only require a simple majority. Here you needed a supermajority to enact new laws. So laws were only infrequently passed. You needed all 13 states to change or amend the articles. So the articles were never changed. There were no amendments because you couldn't get 13 people to agree. Try getting 13 people to agree in a family where to go on vacation. Often that's kind of difficult, and it proved impossible for the states to agree on changes to the articles. And finally, as we said before, they had no executive branch, and so again, no way to enforce laws. Now, in spite of these weaknesses, they did accomplish some things. For example, these are some of the achievements that they did accomplish under the Articles of Confederation. They agreed to a policy to develop lands west of the Appalachian Mountains. Realize that the Appalachian Mountains were the frontier at this point. They came up with a Northwest Ordinance, which is part of their plan. And in that, one of the things that they decided that will carry over to the new Constitution, and it was very important, is that every new state was equal to the old states. So the original 13 states had no kind of super veto power. Any new state entered on an equal footing with all of the states that were currently in this confederation. They did negotiate and sign the peace treaty with Great Britain that ended the Revolutionary War in 1783. They came up with 4 departments for the executive branch, if you will. That's kind of a misnomer. But they came up with the Departments of Foreign Affairs, War, Marine, and Treasury. And this will be the precedent later for the President's Cabinet. Finally, they came up with the Full Faith and Credit Clause, which will also be a part of the Constitution that is written in 1787. The Full Faith and Credit Clause essentially states that a legal contract negotiated in one state, or a legal proceeding that occurs in one state, must be recognized by other states. So if I get married in Virginia and I move to Tennessee, I'm still married. If I buy a car in West Virginia and move to Colorado, it's still my car. If I get divorced in Texas and move to Minnesota, I'm still divorced. And if I have a child custody agreement or an alimony or child support agreement, it stays the same as what was awarded in Texas. Now, this Full Faith and Credit Clause right now with the issue of gay marriage will probably be tested by the Supreme Court in the future, because at its essence, in the eyes of the law, at least, marriage is a contract. That's why when you get divorced, you have to go to court to break the marriage, even if it occurred in a church. And so it'll be interesting to see how the court decides on that, because in most other contractual issues are handled the same through this Full Faith and Credit Clause. This includes, by the way, legal proceedings that are not contracts. If I'm a convicted felon in the state of Virginia and I move to Florida, I'm still a convicted felon, even though I was convicted under Virginia state law. It's a pretty universal agreement, and it's an important thing that we have in the current Constitution. So, why was a stronger government needed? Well, you saw some of the things. Here we have some others. Congress was supposed to be able to settle disputes between the states, and they couldn't do that because they couldn't enforce their own laws, much less enforce any arbitrated settlement that Congress came up with. If Congress in or if Virginia and North Carolina had a disagreement over where the border lay and they went to Congress under the Articles and asked Congress to decide, Congress decided in favor of North Carolina, there was nothing to force Virginia to abide by that agreement. So you couldn't go to Congress to settle disputes, and so that was impotent. They had no money. So essentially, we had no army. One of the main reasons for having a confederation was to try to put a united front between these 13 nation states so that they could have some way to defend themselves against the military powers of Europe. Since they couldn't pay money to soldiers or they had no money to build ships, then there wasn't much of a navy or an army. And so that main reason, one of the main reasons for forming the Confederation, just never materialized. And finally, you have Shays' Rebellion. Shays' Rebellion takes place in late 1786, early 1787. In 1786, several of the states tried to get all the states together to talk about commerce, try to find a way to solve the problems of the Confederation in the areas of commerce because of the inequities between the various states in terms of their fiscal solvency. And only a few states attended the meeting, and so they adjourned and decided to try and meet again in Philadelphia in 1787. And in between the two meetings, Shays' Rebellion occurred. In Massachusetts, every state under the Articles could print their own currency. And so could the national government, but typically all the states had their own national currency. Unfortunately, because the economies of some of the states were so poor, their currencies were essentially worthless. And that was true in Massachusetts, so much so that the state of Massachusetts quit accepting their own paper money as payment for debt to the state. And they required that people pay in gold or silver. Well, many of the farmers in the area had been used to paying their debts essentially through barter, by paying with livestock or crops. But with that new law that was passed by Massachusetts, they could no longer do that. And so a number of them began to lose their homes and thereby their livelihood. Daniel Shays was a former Revolutionary War hero who had turned farmer, and he led a rebellion that had some limited success against the government of Massachusetts because of these farm foreclosures and this policy. They created havoc in a couple of the cities. They broke windows. They actually tarred and feathered one of the tax collectors and rode him out of town on a rail. Massachusetts had no militia to be able to turn out against this rebellion, and so they petitioned the federal government, the national government under the Articles, to send an army to put down this rebellion, and they couldn't do it. By the time they finally got enough soldiers together to send someone, the rebellion had kind of petered out, and the farmers had gone back home. But what this did, what Shays' Rebellion did, was to send a shockwave through the wealthy in this country, the well-to-do, who were involved in either owning their own businesses or owning plantations. And they saw that if you had a government that could not rule, that could not provide order, then you were essentially in a state of anarchy. I mean, think about Hobbes again for a second. Hobbes said in the state of nature, you had anarchy, where the strongest ruled. And in this case, those businessmen saw that in the absence of any civil authority to maintain order, that the people could rebel. And in a sense, you would have anarchy. That's what they saw in Shay's Rebellion. And so when this meeting occurred in Philadelphia in 1787, 12 of the 13 states attended. It was a much better turnout. And they came because the government under the Articles, recognizing that there was a problem, had authorized a constitutional convention, which I just love those letters. Anyway, what they had authorized was a convention to come together and to revise the government under the Articles. It would become much more than that, as we shall see. The people gathered in Philadelphia were a wide range of the elite, if you will, from the various colonies. 55 people, all white, Anglo-Saxon males, of means, highly educated, representing 12 states attended. Rhode Island did not attend. Why do you think Rhode Island did not attend? It's a good question for class. Ask me in class and we'll discuss it. So, they met in Philadelphia. All the men, as I said, had experience in politics. They were fairly well educated. They were generally people of means, people with some wealth. Three people that are important to mention at the beginning is George Washington. Washington, who had been commander-in-chief during the Revolution, was elected president of the Constitutional Convention. Madison becomes known as the father of the Constitution because he is the one who takes the most copious notes of their meetings, and it's one of the ways we can go back and look at some of the intention of those people who were revising or writing a new constitution. And Ben Franklin, who is the oldest person by far at the Constitutional Convention, at the time it was held, he was 81, will be a key negotiator to bring about a compromise that saved the convention and led to our current constitution. Now, I do want to tell a story here, a brief story, but George Washington was elected president of of the Constitutional Convention, largely because he was the only one everyone could trust. Washington had the ability, essentially, to take power because he was in charge of the army. When the war ended, it was the only army, and certainly after the English pulled out their troops over the last couple of years following Yorktown, Washington had the only army in North America, and though it was not that strong, it was certainly strong enough to overthrow the government. And at the end of that time, many of his soldiers, and particularly his officers, had not received any pay. And one day he happened into a meeting where his officers had been discussing this, heatedly discussing the fact that they had not been paid in months. And they had decided that they would march on Philadelphia, where the government was located at that time, and demand to receive payment, or they would overthrow the government. And upon hearing this, Washington engaged in an impromptu discourse about how he would not take up his sword against the government that he had fought this many number of years to establish and preserve, that as for him, he would go back home and be a gentleman farmer. And so with that, he turned, and his speech was so impassioned that many of his officers were crying at the end of it. And there was never any talk of overthrowing the government again. So people knew that Washington could be trusted with power. He had had that chance. He had turned his back on it. And he was one of the few people that they all felt like they could trust. So the basic organization of the convention was that each state would have one vote, just like they did under the Articles of Confederation. They also decided that, unlike the Articles, where you needed a supermajority, 9 out of 13, that you would need a simple majority for each vote that was taken at the convention. And so that would have meant 7 out of 12 states. Their meetings would be secret, and they were so concerned about their meetings being secret that they locked the windows, they nailed the shutters outside the windows shut. Now, this was in one of the hottest summers on record in Philadelphia, at a time when there was no air conditioning, and you remember the kind of clothing that these men wore in the 1700s, pretty heavy stuff. No air conditioning, no electricity, so no fans, in a very hot, stuffy building with a lot of differing opinions about what they should do. They were so dedicated to ensuring that nothing happened, that no one got wind of what they were doing, of the changes that they were making, that they actually assigned two people, two delegates, to follow Ben Franklin everywhere he went. Because Ben Franklin was always, if you ever want to read about an interesting member of the Founding Fathers, Ben Franklin's a great read. He was quite a character. And he liked the ladies, and he always liked to kind of, you know, flirt with the ladies. And they were concerned that he would go out to a pub in the evening, and after a few drinks, he would begin to tell the ladies, charm the ladies with his stories about what were going on at the convention. So they essentially assigned him two handlers to go everywhere he went. I mean, they were very, very intent on making sure that word did not leak out in advance. And again, as we said, originally their intent was simply to revise the articles. Came up with some key agreements very early. First of all, they agreed that they wanted to have a limited representative government, a government that was elected by the people, so a republic, that had limited powers. They wanted to ensure, and we're going back to our discussion of Montesquieu here, that there was a separation of powers, that those powers were divided into three branches. So unlike the government they currently had, they were going to revise the Constitution to include an executive branch and a legislative branch. And once they came up with these two agreements, Edmund Randolph, who was then the governor of the state of Virginia, rose in the convention and proposed that they scrap the Articles of Confederation and adopt a brand new form of government. Randolph is going to introduce a plan written by James Madison, which becomes known as the Virginia Plan. Now, you need to know that, if you don't already, that Virginia at this time is population-wise, and to some extent territory-wise, the largest state in the Union. Has the strongest, with New York, it has one of the two strongest economies in the Union. The Virginia Plan called for some radical changes, and it had the support of the larger states. So they had already done some politicking in advance, behind the scenes. What the Virginia Plan called for was a bicameral legislature, so a two-house legislature. The lower house would be elected directly by the people. The upper house would be elected by the lower house. Representation in both the upper house and the lower house would be based on population. So the larger states would have a larger say in what happened in the government. This legislature would be able to declare state laws unconstitutional. There would be an executive branch that would be chosen by the legislative branch and a judicial branch that would be chosen by the legislative branch. And one of the things that this highlights is that the framers, and this is true also of those representatives of the small states, the framers were afraid of putting too much power in the hands of the people. The populace during this time in our history was largely uneducated. And they have Shays' Rebellion in the back of their mind. So while they want to ensure that the people do have a role in electing and directly electing some of the members of this national government, they want to let those representatives then begin to appoint and elect others who may be of even stronger intellect and character to help run this government. Anyway, the Virginia Plan was not well received by the smaller states, particularly because they saw where the power was going to lie in this government. The power in this government was going to lie with the larger states. They had just given up an opportunity, or just thrown off, if you will, a tyrant of a government from overseas that had lorded power over them. And they did not want to then now voluntarily give power to larger states to lord it over them. And so the convention came close to breaking down. And then a small state introduced another plan. That plan was the New Jersey plan. New Jersey at that time was one of the smaller states population-wise. And in their plan, there were fewer changes, and it was supported by the smaller states. It was kind of an alternative plan that the smaller states proposed. What it called for was a unicameral legislature, very similar to what they had under the Articles, one house legislature, where they would have, just like the Articles, one vote per state, that in each of, that in this legislature, they would have the power to tax and regulate commerce. These were two of the areas under the Articles that had caused so much problem. They couldn't raise money, and they couldn't regulate commerce between the states and foreign countries. So why not make smaller changes and give the national government these powers, which will then solve many, they thought, of the problems under the Articles? They had agreed that they would have a three-branch government, and so they were going to have an executive branch, but this executive branch would not have one leader over it. It would have more than one. It would be a plural, so you'd have two or more people who were over the executive branch. That was never firmly decided, you know, fleshed out. This branch would be chosen by the legislature, and then the judicial branch would be chosen by the executive. So the legislative branch would choose the executive branch, who would then choose the judicial branch. Well, the large states didn't like this, particularly in the fact that they thought, we have more people, we'll be paying more taxes, you know, we'll be contributing more to the national economy, the expenses of the national government. We should have more say in what goes on. So the convention came very close to breaking down and adjourning. Ben Franklin got involved and began to make visits both to the smaller representatives of the smaller states, and then he'd go and visit with representatives of larger states. And so he went back and forth until he was able to help fashion a compromise plan that Connecticut proposed. And it becomes known as, don't you just love these letters? It becomes known as the Connecticut or Great Compromise, the Connecticut Plan or the Great Compromise. And it answers the question of representation of Congress. So it gets the convention off square one and allows them to look at some of the other issues involved. So here's how they did it. The Great Compromise had a bicameral legislature, just like the Virginia Plan had proposed. It had a House of Representatives that was based on the population of the state. So in the House of Representatives, the larger states would have more representation. The larger states wanted to ensure that since they would be contributing the majority of the revenue, that all revenue bills, all money-raising bills, would begin in the House of Representatives. So that was one of the caveats of this great compromise. The House of Representatives would be chosen directly by the people. There would also be a Senate, a separate house, and this Senate would have equal representation per state, two senators per state, so that the smaller states would have equal representation in the Senate. And since the Constitution would require that measures pass both houses in order to become law, the smaller states knew that they had the ability to block legislation that was overly favorable to the large states. And so this kind of gave both sides a measure of what they wanted. And once this was agreed to, it kind of broke the logjam, and they were able to focus on some other issues. So while they had several other issues to deal with, we're going to look at four major ones that were tremendous issues that without these compromises, in all likelihood, the document would have failed to be adopted by the convention. First is the Three-Fifths Compromise. The Three-Fifths Compromise dealt with the issue of slavery. And slavery, you know, is going to continue to be an issue that looms over the country for decades. And then, of course, following the end of slavery, certainly segregation and discrimination have continued to plague the country. But at this time, the issue is over slavery. And the southern states, seeing what had happened with the adoption of the House of Representatives being by population, wanted to take advantage of the number of slaves that they had to increase their representation in the House. South Carolina, for example, at this time, had more enslaved population than they did free. And so to be able to count those slaves for representation purposes would have been huge for them. However, they also wanted to say that slaves were property. And the North saw this as an irony at best, and said, no, you can't count property as people. So they compromised over the issue of taxes. And so what they did was they decided to count, and the way they would count slaves is they would count five slaves equal to three freemen. So if you had five slaves, or I should say for every five slaves that a state had, they could get three additional population figures for their representation in the House of Representatives. However, this was also going to be true for any taxation that was adopted by population. So for every five slaves, there would be counted as three additional members of the population for taxation purposes. Therefore, the North was able to garner some measure of burden on the South for this concession on how to count slaves. The second one also dealt with slave trade, dealt with commerce and slave trade. What it did was to say that there would be no ban on the slave trade for 20 years. All of the states had quit importing slaves except South Carolina, which still imported slaves from overseas. South Carolina would not have agreed to the Constitution if slavery had been banned outright. So what they did was to say that 20 years after the adoption, ratification, if you will, of the Constitution, that the slave trade would be ended. And so since the Constitution was ratified in 1788, that meant that until 1808, the importation of slaves continued to be allowed. However, there was a $10 tax placed on each imported slave. And if you go back and look at the increase in dollar value, what $10 was worth in 1788 versus what it's worth now, You'll see that $10 was a tremendously large tax on each imported slave. But that also gives you an idea of how lucrative the slave trade was for those people who were engaged in it, that they would be willing to pay this $10 tax. When it came to commerce, the national government was going to have power over interstate and foreign commerce. And most commerce came in through shipping, even from state to state. It's more reliable than shipping over land. And so they agreed that no individual port would receive any particular favoritism from the national government. They also agreed that Congress would be able to regulate foreign and domestic trade. And they also said that there would be no tax on exports. The reason for this was to make U.S. goods more competitive overseas. If we tax them here, then they're going to cost more when we try to sell them overseas, and it will hinder our trade ability. And finally, one last slavery issue dealt with escaped slaves. There were more and more states becoming non-slave, and they were reluctant to return slaves who had escaped to a non-slave state back to their owners. The Constitution would allow them to continue, or essentially it would require northern states to return escaped slaves. This was adopted, however, it was never really enforced. Northern states were not going to push people to return slaves who escaped. The final compromise I just want to mention is that over the presidency. There were two main issues here, and that was how the president would be elected and the length of the presidential term. So what they decided to do was to come up with an electoral college. There were some people, including James Wilson from Pennsylvania, who was over what was called a committee on details that hammered out, this committee hammered out some of these issues, that compromises that we're talking about, and then they would bring them to the larger convention to debate and pass. James Wilson was in favor of direct election, but again, you have to remember that they were conducting this convention in the shadow of Shays Rebellion. And these wealthy business owners were concerned that when you gave too much power to the people, this is what happened. It was anarchy. And so the framers essentially believed that too much democracy in the hands of the people could be a bad thing. They didn't want to eliminate democratic principles completely by any means. They believed in democracy, but measured democracy. And so they decided that they would come up with an electoral college where people would be elected who were better educated, who were in a position to know the demands of the presidency, and that those people would then in turn elect a president. Sounds good. Worked for a while, perhaps. Nowadays, the Electoral College simply uses party loyalty. Doesn't matter whether the person's well-educated, doesn't matter if they really know the demands of the presidency. What matters is, are they a loyal party member? If their party wins the state, then they get to vote in the Electoral College. We'll talk about that more in the electoral unit, but that was the hope of the Electoral College, which, by the way, was proposed by Hamilton. The second of the major issues with the presidency was, what's the term of the president going to be? They discussed life. They discussed 2-year terms, 4-year terms, 6-year terms. They discussed 6-year terms without the ability to be reelected. And what they decided upon was that the president would be elected for a 4-year term, that the president could be reelected to another 4-year term for as often as the electors chose to reelect him, and as long as he served on good behavior. The good behavior was not specifically defined. Once the Constitutional Convention approved the document, it created quite a stir when it was released, because the people in the convention had gone well beyond what the government under the Articles had approved. And you had an immediate reaction of those who endorsed or supported this new, stronger central government, and those who were concerned of having a strong central government. I mean, they still, you know, they're only a decade out from having thrown off Great Britain. Less than a decade is having thrown off Great Britain as this tyrant that oversaw them. And many people saw a central government as being a threat to individual liberty and being a threat to democracy. They were afraid that they would be back in a tyrannical government. And so there was a really vicious fight, if you will, for ratification of the Constitution. The Constitution required that 9 of the 13 states ratify the Constitution through their legislatures or through conventions. Most of the states held conventions. New Hampshire became the 9th state to ratify, and they ratified ahead of New York or Virginia, which were the two largest states, who also, in population-wise, and also the states, two states with the largest economy. Geographically, these two states were located, where they were located, if they had not joined, would have divided the other states up into essentially three separate regions. So it was imperative that New York and Virginia ratify the Constitution. Let's look at the two major groups that supported and opposed the Constitution. The group that supported the Constitution quickly named themselves the Federalists to describe this new federal government that they had proposed. They wanted to name themselves before some other group could name them something horrendous. So they adopted the name Federalist. They were in favor of ratification of the Constitution. Several of the people, just to mention three, Hamilton, Jay, and Madison. Alexander Hamilton would be Secretary of the Treasury. He was an advisor to Washington for years prior to the adoption of the Constitution. And he was nominally the leader of the Federalist Party. John Jay was the governor of New York. He will later be the first Supreme Court Chief Justice. He will resign that position to negotiate the Jay Treaty, which you should be familiar with Great Britain. And then he will come back to be governor of New York again. And James Madison, father of the Constitution, from the state of Virginia. All three of those were strong Federalists. Together, they wrote the Federalist Papers, which were essays that were printed in New York newspapers and publications to try and sway delegates to the New York Convention to adopt the Constitution. People who generally supported the Constitution and tended to be Federalists were merchants and people who lived along the seaboard, because they needed a government that would be strong enough to settle some of the disputes with trade that had been going on under the Articles, and so they were very supportive of having a stronger government. If they had a motto, the motto would have been that there's no strength through anarchy. They would have argued that you needed a stronger government, because look what happened under the Articles. Shay's Rebellion occurs on a regular basis. We have essentially no government. There is no strength through anarchy. Their opponents took the name Anti-Federalist to differentiate themselves from the Federalist. They were against ratification of the Constitution. Some prominent names include Thomas Jefferson, Patrick Henry of the Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death speech fame, George Mason, John Hancock. All of these patriots, yes, but not in favor of having a stronger central government, very wary of a strong central government. They also wrote essays in response to the Federalist Papers. And scholars still go back to both the Federalist and the Anti-Federalist Papers to look at what the arguments were for the for and against the original Constitution. Generally speaking, farmers and laborers, more common people, were against the central government, a strong central government. They were much more comfortable with their state governments and governments close to home. They were afraid of having a tyrannical government. And their biggest complaint, biggest argument they would have raised, is that the strong, new strong central government that had been proposed had no guarantee of a Bill of Rights for the people. That their biggest concern, which was the elimination of civil liberties, was certainly a concern when there was no Bill of Rights. So, the Federalists realized early on in the fight, even though some states adopted the Constitution very quickly, they realized that in order to get the Constitution approved, they were going to have to add a Bill of Rights. And so several of them promised that that they would do that in the Virginia and New York Convention. With Madison, in fact, not only in the convention, but when he ran for the first Congress as a representative from the state of Virginia, he ran against James Monroe. And he promised in his campaign that if he were elected, he would introduce a Bill of Rights in the first Congress, which he did. As you know, and this is kind of a rehash of stuff we've already said, Virginia and New York were definitely needed because of the size and population of the population, the geography, and also the size and strength of their economies. And the Federalist Papers were written for the New York debate. The new government is approved with the ninth state ratifying the Constitution. Virginia and then New York ratify the Constitution with very close votes. North Carolina, which had rejected the Constitution, came back after the introduction of the Bill of Rights and adopted the Constitution, as did Rhode Island. George Washington is elected the first president. He is a unanimous election by the Electoral College in both his initial election and his second election. In those days, the way the Constitution was written, this changed after the election of 1800, but until 1800, the way the Constitution was written was that whoever got the most votes would be president, whoever got the second most votes from the Electoral College would be vice president. That turned out in both cases to be John Adams. So he is the vice president. The Capitol is initially going to be in New York City. It is a temporary Capitol. Washington was inaugurated on Wall Street. And the government, for both of his inaugurations, the government moved shortly after the second inauguration to Philadelphia. And we will talk later on about how it ended up in Washington, D.C. So that's the end of this PowerPoint, and we look forward to talking about some of these things in class.